Hello everyone. In this video, we will discuss about a broad overview of threads. So what are threads? It is the basic unit of CPU utilization. So here we know about what is process. A program in execution is nothing but process. So we can have lot of process in the system in order to execute any kind of operation. So if you want to execute any one of the process, suppose in that process you are instructed to perform one operation, like, so you want to print any of the document. So that is what your process. So printing one document is said to be one process. So which means you are not going to print the entire document. So you're going to print the first page of that particular file. So for that, you need some of the input. So what are all the input that are required to perform this operation? So first one, you need what is the name of that file. So once you get the name of the file, you have to open that file. So what are all the sequence of operation that you need to perform for executing the single process? Single process may represent some set of operations, some sequence of operations, right? So first you have to get the input as the file name. Once you get the input, you have to open that file name. So this is a next operation. So after opening that file, so you need to select the particular page that you want to print. So you are going to print only the first page, not the entire content. So you have to select the first page to print. And then you have to proceed with the print option. So you press enter for performing the print operation, right? So all these are said to be the sequence of operation that we need to perform for a single process. So in traditional operating system, we have the process which consists of only one threads. So threads are nothing but, so if you are performing a single task of execution, so that is what thread. Suppose in the same example, what I have told now, so here we have taken one process that is going to print one page of a particular file. So for that, how many number of operation that it has to perform? All those operation which we can also say, which we can also call as a task, right? So sequence of task could be performed for executing that particular process. So a single task of execution is said to be thread. Say for example, in order to get the input from the user, we can assign one thread. In order to perform that task, we can assign one thread. And so in order to open that particular file, we can assign one thread. In order to select that particular first page or any other page that you need to print, so we can assign one thread. So this is what thread. A single task of execution or single operation in the process is said to be a thread. So in traditional operating system, a process which consists of only one thread. So that is a single threaded process we can see only in traditional operating system. But in modern operating system now, we are actually working with multi-threaded environment, which means for a particular process, we may have many more number of threads. So that is what multi-threaded environment. So we will discuss what are all the drawbacks we have faced in single-threaded and how we have overcome all those drawbacks in the single-threaded by multi-threaded environment. So we will discuss everything, okay? So before that, we know what is thread. So it is a basic unit of CPU utilization. We can also say define the thread like that. So the thread may consist of some information. So similar to the process, this thread will also have some information. So this will have same functionality of the process. This thread must have the same functionality of the process. Because in the process only, we will be creating a single thread or multiple threads, right? So it will have the same concept of whatever the process will do. All those things it will also hold. So let us see. What are all the information that we need to maintain if you are going with the threading environment? So this thread ID, so which is nothing but some unique identifier you should be given for each and every threads. If you are working with a multi-threaded environment, so then you should identify each and every thread separately. For that, we have one unique ID. So that might be assigned to each and every thread. So that is what thread ID. program counter. So what for we are having this register? It is the same purpose as usual. So it will hold the next instruction address in order to be executed next. Right. So the next instruction address will be stored in this program counter. With that, we can execute the next instruction sequentially. So that is what the purpose of program counter. And next, it will have some register set. It will hold some working variables information, some content about the variables. So whatever the variables you're going to use, or whatever the data that you are going to use to perform any set of operation in the threads, so that will be stored in the register set. And it will also have a stack data structure. So in order to store the different state of the process. So in the same way for the process, we have different states. We also have different states for threads. So what is the current state of the thread so that we need to save, and we can reload it when you are resuming that same thread? Because it is very similar to the multi-processing, multi-programming environment. So if you are working with the multi-threading environment, so here also the switches between the different number of threads is possible by the CPU. So it has to save the current status of a thread, and afterwards it will reload. After executing some other operation, it will reload it again, or it will resume it in order to continue its execution. So for that, we need this stack. Even for the threads, we have all these kind of storage information. And the next one, code section, data section, operating system resources. So whenever any process wants to execute, so initially all the resources will be allocated to the process by the operating system. Similarly, the threads will also take over the control of all those resources in order to perform their own set of operations. So for that, it needs operating system resources like open files and signals and also some accounting information. So everything will be stored in this. For each and every thread, we will use all these information in order to execute the threads by the CPU. So here, similar to the process, so in the process, all these information will be stored in a one table called process control block. Otherwise, it is also called as process table. Similarly, we are mentioning for the threads, we have one block is said to be, or a table is said to be, thread control block. So thread control block, so which is used to hold the information about the currently executing threads. So as I told, for a traditional operating system, we have used only the single threaded process. But nowadays, we are actually working with the multi-threaded process. So we will see, or we will discuss about the comparison on these two environments. So what are all the things we are getting in case of single threaded? So before going to the comparison of these two processes, so we should know about why we are going to threads. Why we want to have threads? So there are actually many reasons that we need to know about why we are actually working with threads. The first main reason is, so there are many applications or there are many activities that it has to divide into a sequential set of operations. So just now also I gave one example. So for performing any one operation that belongs to a single process, we need several set of instructions or the task that need to perform sequentially. So in that case, and one operation can be, or one process can be divided into a simple several task. So for that, we are actually proceed with this threads. So for that, we need these threads. And the next reason is, so if you are going to work only with the process and we don't have the concept of thread, so what happens there? So it is actually taking all the resources from the operating system, and also it will communicate with each other in between the process. We can also switch between the process. Everything is possible, but it is somewhat time consuming and somewhat costly. So when you are working only with the process, because it has to share everything, even both physically as well as logically, with other process. Right. But if you're working with the threads, anyways, all the threads will belongs to the same process. So no need of having any separate mechanism in order to share all the resources. So not only the resources, apart from the resources, even if it has this like code sections or a data section, so it is going to share with all other threads. with all other threads, it will share all these things. It is not going to have separately these kind of code section or a data section. So for that, we are actually going with this thread concept. So it is somewhat more easier and also more faster than the process. And the next one is computation speed up. So though we are dividing the several tasks, whatever we have for each and every threads, we are actually assigning all these tasks to each and every thread. So we are dividing it and we are assigning to each and every thread. So what happens there? Within a very short period of time, so we will be getting the result, whatever the user wants, right? So we are increasing the, the computation speed up will be more. So we are reducing the response time. So that is what the why we are going with the threads concept. And one more thing, it will be more useful on the systems with multiple CPU, which is nothing but multi-processing environment, or even in multi-core environment. So if you are just implementing the concept of threads, so it will really helpful for, and it will give you the real parallelism technique. So we can achieve with the real parallelism technique if you use the threads concept in case of multi-processing or a multi-core environment. Okay. So these are all some of the reason that why we are actually going to the threads concept. And the next one is where the threads are useful. So I'll tell about, so where these threads are useful effectively. So are used effectively. So I will explain with the two examples. So first example, so if you are just working with the word processor. Okay, so what it will do, so there will be lot of operations so that we can perform. So several simple operations will be there. You can edit the document, you can copy the document, you can paste in some other document, right? And you can modify any of these things internally, like in the first page or in the second page. Suppose if you are working with the process that does not have any threads, okay, so what happens there? If the user wants to change the first page of that particular document, right? So that document consists of 600 pages. And I mean the word processor consists of 600 pages. So if he wants to change some of the content in the first page, and afterwards directly he actually wants to switch to the 600th page, okay? Or the 500th page. So what happens there? It takes more time to move on to that particular page what he has selected, because what it will do, that particular process has to reformat the whole document starting from the first page to that 500th page, because he has done some changes in the first page itself. So he has to refresh all the pages till it reaches the 500th page. So it takes lot of time. So he feels more difficult to interact with the document, that particular user, right? So that's why if you are using the threads for the same concept, for the same application, if you go and check with the threads concept, so what happens there? Suppose if you are producing multiple threads for the particular process, so what happens if you are having say for example two threads? So one thread will be given for the in order to interact with the user. The second thread will be given for reformatting, so which means whatever the operation which that document has to perform whenever it gets any modification, right? This is actually the thread illustration. So here we have the process. So in this process, it consists of three threads actually. The first thread, what it is doing, so it is the interactive thread, which is nothing but it is getting some input from the user. So user, whatever the instruction he is providing, so it will get all those things through the keyboard. And afterwards, the third thread, which is nothing but, I will tell you about the second thread. So second thread is nothing but the formatting thread, or the reformatting thread, which is used to perform the operation whatever it is done in the document, right? So whether it is a read operation or any modification or any other write operation, so it will perform all these things. So it will take care, this particular thread will take care of all those operations. And still we have one more thread, that is which is used to keep the backup of the document in the disk. So because the document, whatever it currently executed by the CPU, will be stored in the main memory, because CPU will fetch everything only from the main memory. So it will not have the direct intervention from the secondary memory, that is the disk. So what we have to do, we should have some backup copy of this in the disk also. For that, we have one assigning one thread, so to take care of that particular task. So this is what multi-threading environment. So how we are getting more beneficial if you are working with the multi-threading and with the single rather than the single threading process. Okay, so now you will get more about this single threaded versus multi-threaded. So why we are actually going with this multi-threaded concept. So even if it is single threaded, so it takes more time in order to perform all those operations. And when the user is more faster than the process, then it will not be more efficient. So that's why you are going with the multi-threaded. And we will discuss one more example also. This is actually the example given for web server, which means so there is one web server, and in the web server, it will keep on getting only the request from the clients. So there will be more number of clients who are giving request to the web server, and the web server has to respond it. Suppose the user, there could be some pages, web pages, which is heavily used by the multiple user. Right. So more number of user who is actually wants to open some particular page. And so if you are taking one page, right, so one browser, so the user will keep on concentrate only on the home page of that browser. Right. So you will not get into in detail about the any other page internally. So the home page will be heavily used by the clients. By more number of clients in the web browser. So whenever he is any of the user trying to click on that home page, right? So which is heavily used. So what the web server will do? So web server will treat this particular page as a heavily used page, and web server will keep this particular home page information in the page cache. So web page cache, which is nothing but the cache memory. So inside the cache memory itself, it will keep these heavily used pages. So frequently, if you are accessing this kind of pages, so we can reduce the access time. So if you store all those things in the cache memory. So how we can perform those things with the multi-threaded environment? So here we have the web page, web server. So what the web server will do, it will have many number of threads. So one is nothing but dispatcher thread, and the next one is worker thread. So here the dispatcher thread, what it will do? So it will keep on receiving only the request from different clients. That is what the task assigned to this dispatcher thread. So what it will do? It will keep on receiving only the request. So nothing other than it will perform any other operation. It will not do any other operation. So next one, after receiving the request, what it will do? It will assign to any other worker threads. These are all nothing but the worker threads. So we may have many number of worker threads. Whichever the worker thread is idle, so it will check that. So whichever the worker thread is blocked, is in blocked state, so only to that worker state it will assign this request. So it will dispatch the received request to any of the worker thread which sits idle, right, which is not performing anything. So it belongs to the blocked state. So threads also have some number of states which is very similar to process, like running state, ready state, blocked state, and waiting state, blocked or waiting state. So if the worker thread is blocked currently to that worker thread, so it will assign that particular request. So it will examine that after receiving that request, what the worker thread will do. So it will examine the request, and afterwards it will check with the web page cache, which is present in the cache memory or not. Suppose if that particular request is not present in the cache memory, so what it will do? It has to read that particular thing from the disk. So from the disk, it has to read the particular page information, and afterwards it will provide the response to that particular request. So while it is performing the read operation on disk, it will be blocked automatically. right? So suppose this particular worker thread, so it is accessing, it is checking whether that accessed page is available in the web page cache. If it is not available, then it will move and check it with the disk. Okay, so it has to read that particular content from the disk. So while performing this read operation, so this thread will be in blocked state. So this will be blocked automatically. Okay, and afterwards, after getting the read, the particular content from the disk, it will be resumed and it will give it to the web client, whoever it is requesting that web page, right? So this is what the thing which it performed in the web server. So here, if you have the multi-threading concept, so this will be performed. Suppose the same thing, how will be performed in a single-threaded process? We can also see that. In case of single-threaded process, so we will be having only one thread, and it takes care of all, it takes care of all the responsibilities. It has to receive the request and it has to check it with the web page cache. If it is not available, then it has to read that same thing from the disk. So what it is doing, so it is actually more time consuming task. So time consuming means, so because it has only one thread, so it has to perform all those things. So it is a time consuming thing, right? So there is one more possibility which we can have under single threaded process, which means it will receive the request and it will check it with the web page cache. So if the cache memory does not hold that information, then it will read that particular thing from the disk. So in that time, this particular process will not be blocked at all. So even it is a single threaded, so that particular process will not be blocked at all. So while it is reading or performing the read operation from the disk, it will not be blocked, which is nothing but non-blocking read operation. Non-blocking read operation or non-blocked read operation. So it will perform. So if it works under this state, so what happens there? It will go and check it. It will receive the next request at that time. So while it is reading the content from the disk, it will go and receive the next request from the next client. So the CPU would not sit idle. Even the web server or the CPU would not sit idle in this case. But what happens here also, we are getting one of the drawback, which means, so it keeps on receiving all the requests, but whatever the thing it is reading from the disk, so that may not happen immediately because it is going and check it with the next request. So this may not happen immediately. So once it is blocked, then this these things will be get back again soon, right? But if it is in a non-blocked state, so it is not responding to this read operation, it is go and check it with the next request, and afterwards it is coming back again in order to get the content from the disk, but it is taking much more time. So it is not said to be much more interactive with the user. So that is what the drawback we are facing in this particular concept. So let us see how we differentiated the characteristics here. So that